what exactly are we talking about? Because our mind is so dazzled with folklore, and we cannot separate folklore from fact. Too many times we swear by folklore, not knowing that it has nothing to do with facts.
All right.
Who exactly is a Jew?
All right.
There was no word called Jew in the ancient world. The word Jew did not come out of Africa. It did not come out of Western Asia. It is a European word. There are people of the Hebrew faith all over the world. There are black Hebrew, there are brown Hebrew, there are yellow Hebrew. How is it that a bunch of Europeans called Jews dominate the word Jew to the extent of making you think that the very faith Hebrew is exclusive to them, leaving out all other people?
All right.
We become prisoners to circumstances in history, becoming prisoner to these circumstances in history. We still react to this conquest of the mind. In slavery, we wanted to associate ourselves with the people who had escaped from something. So we read a Jewish escape story called the Exodus, and we believed it. And we didn't examine the story, because if you examine the story, you will find the story is told to instill faith in a people. And sometimes, if a story is told to instill faith and truth, the illustration used to get the point across need not be true.
All right. All right.
Tell me, how can 600,000 people cross the Nile, cows, children, goats, sheep, get on the other side, no laws? The Nile just dried up. It must have been muddy, and they didn't even get their feet muddy. Now, you can do it with imagination, but in fact, you can't do it. They copied, these Western Asian people copied Nile Valley folk stories, personified themselves into the story, and sold you your own story, and you bought it. Now let's go back and deal with where they copied the story from. There's a three-volume work published by the University of Chicago on Egyptian literature. I would appreciate it if the people on my right would just let me be heard. Dealing with Egyptian literature. And there is a story in the three volumes dealing with a pharaoh who got somewhat despondent, and his magician decided to take him rowing on the Nile. And to make him more happy, the boat was being rowed by beautiful ladies. The lead lady stopped rowing and started crying, and the Pharaoh was very much concerned with what had happened. And he asked the lead lady what had happened. He said she had dropped her necklace in the Nile. And the Pharaoh told the magician to take care of it. At this period in history, all kings or pharaohs travel with a magician. Instead of you and I having a fight, we have a contest between our respective magicians. We didn't take the nation to war. The two magicians settled the matter. So this magician parted the water, dried up the Nile, stepped out, picked up the lady's necklace, gave it back, water came back, she smiled, and he kept rowing the boat over. That's why the Jews copied the story about the part of the water. What I am saying is that at this period in history, there was no such thing as a Jew. There were Western Asian people who later joined the Hebrew faith. There was an extensive series on the history of the Jews. They gave them an artificial history before Babylonia. But they had no clear history before their entry into Africa as visitors seeking food and shelter. There in Africa, they sought and found food and shelter. They entered Africa with no clear language, no clear religion, and no clear culture. When they left, they came as 70 in number. They left 600,000 in number. They had a culture, a language, and a religion when they left, all taken from Africa. They were not Hebrews when they got there, but they were Hebrews when they left. Now you join the religion as though you got to do it with their permission, because the European Jews of the faith gave you the illusion that everything must be dispensed to you because you invented nothing and you achieved nothing. And there in the Nile Valley, in the river valleys of Africa, you had set in motion the social thought that would be the foundation of what you know as Western civilization. And yet you have forgotten how to claim it. Now, these visitors came into Africa in the 1700s B.C., led by our patron father, Abraham. 1675, Africa was invaded from Western Asia. Instead of taking the side of the Africans, they took the side of the invaders. But while under the invaders, where they served as collaborators and clerks, and betrayals of their African friends, They produced the world's first wheeler-dealer politician called Joseph the Provider. The Africans came back to power and said, those who wish to now obey African rule may stay, the rest will have to go. The African king came to power, and that is the king who knew not Joseph, the king who owed the Jews no favor, and the wheeler-dealer politician Joseph did not have any power around the throne, because the throne was now an African throne. In their early contact with us was as wheeler dealers, and they entered human history with that visit to Africa. They have never been our friends when we needed them. In the concept of a historical alliance between African people and people called Jews is a lie and a myth and a misconception. They overplayed every event in history. With us, but anytime it was to their benefit, they have walked away from us. We are one of the most politically naive people in history. We have never made a good alliance with anybody, and everybody that has come among us have shown that they would betray us anytime it was to their benefit. There is no exception, right or left. That's true of every religion, it's true of every politics, and it's true of every single ethnic group. Now, you want to play a whole lot of ethnic partner games, I think you should make alliance with other ethnic groups, but watch the alliance. You should be partners, but when people break the alliance, you should be in a position to punish them.
All right.
And don't depend too much on the alliance.
All right.
Now, after this period, we have to deal with it now, because we are not dealing with Jews, because there are no Jews at this juncture in history. There is no Europe at this juncture in history. We're talking about Western Asian people. At this juncture, what you call the Middle East, that I call Western Asia, was Northwest Africa. And this is documented in a book called When Egypt Ruled the East. All of those Mediterranean mulattoes and Indo-Europeans who would drift down to this area later wasn't there at this time in history. We are not arguing about the color of that vast number of people, because the only semi-European people, and they were mixed, were the Romans and the Greeks. We are not arguing about the color of Christ. I don't argue his blackness. I argue his non-Europeanness.
Right.
His non-whiteness.
All right.
Ain't no possibility that he could have been white.
Yeah. All right.
Now, when we look at what we are talking about, in the change of the world, let's look at this event in history and the reaction to it Is it incidental that while carrying the cross up the hill, he's got 12 disciples? None of them stepped forward to help him with the cross.
How about that?
Who came forward? An Ethiopian, Simon of Cyrene. Could this be a brother helping a brother? Otherwise, why nobody else helped him? Took that cross up that hill. I'm trying to show you where we related to the humanity of all people, but all people have not related to our humanity. We have been the true believers. Now, after the Romans destroyed the last temple of the people of the Hebrew faith, 70 AD, now you got to watch it. You've got to study the migration patterns of the world. Where did those Western Asian people go? I see no migration pattern that took them into Europe. I do see a migration pattern that took a large number of them into inner West Africa, where a large number of people of the Hebrew faith lived in ancient Ghana, lived in peace up until 770 AD, when they tried to collaborate with the Arabs to take over the country, and the Africans expelled them from the country. We have illusions about people. Some time ago, someone was arguing about who's our friend, and I was at one of those very fancy parties, all tuxedoed down, and I was talking to another great scholar, also all tuxedoed down, and I said that I would not be surprised if the day would come when I would see the Jews and the Arabs in the same political bed against the African people. The professor who was listening to me, who was well known and has a name similar to mine, was livid. And we could not misbehave among all those millionaires and well-dressed, well-perfumed ladies. And so all I said is that competent historians do the same thing to prove their cases as competent lawyers. They cite a precedent. They point where it has already happened. There has already been a relationship between Africans and Jews and Arabs in Spain for 800 years, when the African was the military arm that held Spain and the Mediterranean. And when they lost the power, the Arabs and the Jews came together, turned on the Africans, and began to enslave them. The Jews went to Holland and found the Dutch East India and the Dutch West India Company, and subsequently helped to find South Africa. That's my precedent. If you want another one, I'll give you another one. Now, the same thing is happening in Detroit right now. Well, there's a large Arab population and a Jewish population. Uh-oh. The same thing is happening around the Sea Island of Georgia, where they're pushing a lot of these blacks out of those islands in Georgia to build condos. Jews and Arab money together against blacks. My point is that these two people allegedly Semitic, neither one happened to be our friend. I have not heard a Jewish professor or any other professor give me a clear definition of a Semitic. If you can't tell me what is a Semitic, you can't tell me what is an anti-Semitic. Now, as the population calling themselves Hebrews flourished in North Africa and in Western Asia, and this continued, and the population in Africa flourished until they were pushed back to North Africa, until the 12th century in Europe, most of these Europeans were Christians and other European denominations. There was a fierce fight between the Arabs and the Christians. One group who did not want to belong to either one sought an option. And the option was the Hebrew faith. So what you are calling Jews are Europeans of the Hebrew faith. Many times they live in communities of their choice. They did certain kinds of work that other Europeans did not want to do and became so good at it, they dominated it. Portable wealth, gold, jewelry. And because they sold small things called jewelry, out of which came the word Jew. A European word that has nothing to do with their origin in Western Asia or Northern Africa, when they were just Western Asian people of the Hebrew faith. You find large numbers of people of the Hebrew faith in India. You find some in China, some in the South Sea Island. But the European tries to dominate everything he is a part of. And nothing came from the European mind that did not have as its intention the facilitation of the European domination of the world. This is the essential mission of every European, whether he is a capitalist, a communist, a Christian, a holy roller. This is the essential mission of Europeans, to dominate everything inside. And their crisis now is they are realizing that between the Africans and the Asians and the people of the South Sea Islands, they keep on having an increase in birth rate, and they keep on going to bed and not bringing it all. Very soon, they're not only going to be a minority, but a tiny minority. All right. They cannot say that Africans or Asia has as their intention the conquest of Europe, because neither one of them wants a thawed out icebox that is agriculturally dying, that is politically dead. So the greatest punishment we can inflict on them is to leave them in their misery. While they are trying to hook into so many things that are ours, is that is their lease on life. Now, because of difference of opinion on religion and finance, the people in Europe of the Hebrew faith in their various branches became good at certain bargaining things, money lending, fabric design and fabric manufacturing, theater management, department store management. And in Germany, where they had department stores, they had the fabrics, they had communication, then they were literally asked, yield something. Then when they did not yield, a madman said, I'll take everything. Now, I have no problem condemning Adolf Hitler's murder, whether it was 6 or 6 million, it was wrong. But this was a European problem started in Europe by Europeans. I am sick of these Europeans washing everybody's face with this and not confronting this as a European problem. Go to Europe and get it settled. Those are the ones who started it. Now, in the 1880s, a lot of people of the Hebrew faith had the illusion that they were just like other Europeans, that they were integrated. And once they got their behinds kicked and were excluded out of things, they began to have the idea that they needed a state of their own. They didn't exactly know where the state would be, but they drew the idea of a state from mythology, because they never had a state that wasn't stolen property. Their homeland of the European Jew is Europe. Now they can go back into folklore and mythology and tell you about a god named Yahweh who told them to get to Palestine and get their homeland. But who told you that God was ever in the real estate business? All right. And who told the God that Palestine was unoccupied? Always occupying something that's already occupied and throwing out somebody else. Now, the Rothschilds controlled the purse of Napoleon. He offered them Palestine and they scoffed at it. So who want that sea of sand? They didn't want it then. They were doing all right in Europe, in the banking industry, in the theater industry. But when things began to pinch them, they began to reconsider. But they considered Brazil one. Any space big enough to be called a homeland. We should read Cam Weisman's autobiography, Trial and Error, and his approach to Chamberlain and his approach to the British. When he said that we will not only be a baston to hold back the Asian hordes, we will preserve civilization and the communication system in Eastern Africa. Look at Palestine geographically. It's a door that swings three ways. It's at the back door of Europe, the side door of Western Asia, and the front door of Africa. Strategically, it is well located. It never, absolutely never, belonged to any European people. And this is another thing that might shock some of our Muslim friends. In all honesty, in early history, it wasn't belong to the Arabs either.
Yeah. All right.
That's a fact, brother.
It was an African country.
Yeah.
The Arabs didn't get there in any appreciable number until about 1600 A.D. I'm not saying they shouldn't live there, but as a matter of historical fact, it's not the original home of the Arabs either. But people don't even ask questions about the Arabs. Now, at the time Zionism was born, Europe and its colonialism was cutting up Africa. The British Empire was spread across the world and the sun wasn't setting on it. A corrupt Belgian king had houses of prostitution throughout Europe and was supporting all of them, although some of them he couldn't visit but once a year. And the prostitutes had full support all the year round. Leopold, spending a lot of money, he needed to look around for some place to make some money. The Germans, who had been left out of the colonial scramble, wanted to get in on it somehow. So the conference was held in Berlin. The Germans hosted it. Out of the conference, the Belgians got the Congo, the French got large areas of equatorial Africa. Later, the Germans would get four good pieces in Africa, Tanzania, Namibia, Southwest Africa, then called the Cameroons and Togo. Portuguese would get a little more. The largest piece really actually went to the French. They got all of equatorial Africa, equivalent of about 16 nations out of it. Not a single African was consulted. The main thing is that slavery was a business. Jews in countries where slavery was a business was just as much in the business as anyone else, and no apologies.
All right.
In the colonial business, they were just as much in it as anyone else. In the domination of the West Indian trade, they were just as much in it as anyone else. That's a book called Barbados, the First Israel by Lionel Hutchison. When the Jews were driven out of England before Cromwell invited them back, Barbados was more of a Jewish, was the leading Jewish colony of the world. And when we look at Christopher Columbus and his exploration, why did some countries in South Africa, South America have 16 synagogues? If they didn't have no Jews, what would they do with so many synagogues? And who was Columbus in the first place? No one ever proved he was Spanish. No one ever proved he was Italian. There's seven different places where they say he was born. Faker, hustler, con man who discovered nothing. Some evidence proved he was Jews. Why did the Jews have to leave Spain? They were the money managers of Spain, the grandees. All this is so well documented. There's a book by a Jewish writer, I think, William Katz, and it's called Israel in Europe. Read the chapter called The Jews in Spain. The Africans and the Arabs installed them in Spain as the money managers. When the Africans and the Arabs lost in Spain, they had no mercy in turning on both of them.
Thank you.
Spain was widening up. If Spain was widening up and expelled the Africans and the Arabs and expelled the Jews too, Spain didn't consider the Jews white, didn't consider the Arabs white, it didn't consider the Africans white, of course. The Dutch East India, the Dutch West India Company, and the chartered companies from England set colonialism in motion. My main point is that Zionism and the spread of colonialism walk side by side. In the mythological historical alliance people are speaking about never existed. And that the infiltration of Jews into our organizations, conspicuously giving a dollar and making sure their picture got taken while they're giving it, was an element of control.
All right. All right.
Their job was to control the mind. They filtered into positions in education where they could control the curricula, which is the control of the mind. This is the heart and soul of the viciousness of what Zionism has done. You've got Holocaust curriculums mandated. Our children now must write essays on the Holocaust and dare not study the history of slavery. And you got teachers who will not teach African history and can get away with it because the union is not going to do anything about it.
All right.
Someone took exception to me referring to a Jewish academic mafia.
Mm-mm.
There is a Jewish academic mafia.
All right. All right.
And people are afraid of that academic mafia.
All right.
I encountered that just today. We were supposed to go with our brothers and discuss Zionism, its history, its mechanics. And some of our brothers decided that maybe the subject is a little too delicate.
Yeah.
So we had to come here in the slave theater and talk about it.
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
All right.
All right. And yet we've always had a sympathetic attachment to the Jewish people because we think they are the people of the book. That's because we don't know the book. We're talking about Europeans, no different from any other European, right, as racist as any other, right, Europeans, as ruthless as any other Europeans.
All right.
You think you're talking about Moses' relatives.
That's right.
Moses had nothing to do with the people we're talking about.
All right.
What you need to learn from Zionism, because it is unique in its organization, is the fact that you need to organize Pan-Africanism across all ethnic lines, all religious lines. We need to stop talking about those specks of dust called islands where slave ships put us down and concentrate on where the slave ship took us from. All came from Africa. We need to create a world movement of African people, put our finances together. I just got a transcript of something today that I'm developing into a pamphlet, Pan-Africanism as a Priesthood. I said we need to make a priesthood out of being free. We need to departmentalize our lives where so many of our young people who devote their entire life just to making sure that black people have fresh water.
Right.
So man, let's make sure that our people have good shoes.
That's right.
He belonged to the shoe sainthood.
That's right.
Priesthood of the shoemaker.
All right.
And be honored. Come and say, oh, this is a nice shoemaker. Those are the people who keep us in shoes.
All right.
That's the people who takes care of the farm.
All right.
Those are the mechanic priesthood. Same as any other sainthood. All right, you under the Catholics got the saints for the sailors, saints for the widows, saints for the, all these different people. Don't make no problem for you. Why should it be a problem when we've got people to do something of everything that we need in order to survive, to stay on this earth? We came out of a society of our own creation where no one was ever alone and unattended to.
All right.
No teenage pregnancy. Mm-hmm. No girl of a certain age not married.
All right.
No mixed people and no mixed up people.
All right.
Nobody with a problem that nobody that they couldn't talk to. Yet no psychiatrist, no sociologist, none of these fineology people.
That's right.
And yet we were getting along. Our heads were straight, no heart attacks,
right,
no strokes, nobody shouted. No nervous breakdowns. We must have been doing something right. Now let's look at Zionism and let us close, because Zionism is an extension of European mechanism of world dominance. You think it's something to deal with finding a homeland for mistreated people. There's a lot of people involved in Zionism who could care less about whether the Jews had a homeland or not. There's discrimination in Israel between the Sephardics and the Ashkenazis, fighting for the upper hand in Israel. They don't want Arabs, who's supposed to be Semitics. They surely don't want blacks, where they got their religion from in the first place. Israel is nothing but an outpost and a listening post for European world dominance. Here's a nation that can take 25-mile corridor inside of another nation's country, and they're not even called imperialists. They need a safety zone. Now, suppose America needed a safety zone between her and Canada, take 25 miles inside of Canada. That's my safety zone.
You better not come
in. Your own country. So let's stop romanticizing all of this. Suppose let's read some of the literature of the Bible. Read the Bible. Don't throw it away. It's a great piece of literature. But read your interpretation of it. They whiten it up. Now you blacken it up. Look at it from your point of view. Read some of John Jackson's work on it. Pagan origins of the Christ myth. Christianity before Christ. It was all old before they formalized it and dogmatized it. Because the people called Jews are a small number of people, because they practice the essential selfishness of survival, in order to stay on this earth, they had to be, thought they had to be manipulators, and they're good at it. They never fight their real enemy. They must always create an enemy to fight, but they want an enemy that they can win. They make enemies out of us because we have such a sentimental attachment to them. We don't fight back because if we fought back, we're fighting the people of the book. And then we look at that white Christ in our church, oh, now we're fighting his people. Then you hold back. And that's Michelangelo's picture he painted. Told you it was Christ. He never saw Christ. You know more. You know no more about it than I do. Give them credit. They psyched the world.
That's right.
They ran the game. 3% of the population.
Right.
You 12 to 15%. They got 10 times more senators than you've got, more people in the House of Representatives you've got, more well-placed people in every agency of government than you've got. They work at putting their people in strategic places to look after their interests. They work at putting their people in strategic places in our organization so they could watch us and control us. We are the only people who integrate on the executive level. They integrate on the lower level, but not on the watching level, not on the boardroom level. Let's make a reassessment of our role in Africa.
That's right.
And look at this generation that failed to deliver. Look at the Caribbean generation that failed to deliver because of their color fascination. Look at the Africans who created imitation European states and failed to deliver one single African state. And look at integration as a bag of worms because we were integrating into disaster. We have to stop letting people confuse us.
That's right.
Ain't no mystery about Zionism. It's just the people practicing the essential selfishness of survival, mm-hmm. looking after themselves.
That's right.
Well, no compunction mm-hmm. about looking after themselves at our expense
That's
or anybody
right.
else's expense if they could get away with it.
That's right.
You have to ask the question there. 350 white hate groups in this country. Mm-hmm. Jews are not fighting any of them.
That's right.
Yet they're fighting us.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's right.
You would think with their memory of Nazism, they would burn down the headquarters of the American Nazi Party.
That's right. Right.
Haven't touched it. You think they would kick the behind of every clean head, a slick head, hadn't touched the one of them.
Right. That's right.
It's an argument between white and white then.
That's right.
Right.
They won't take on you because you got confusion about the people of the book.
That's right.
Easy victory.
Mm-hmm. Let's look inward at ourselves and some of the differences among ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Peter Noel called me about that silly article he had in the Village Voice, and I was planning to write an article in rebuttal, but I told him between Alton Maddox and Reverend Sharpton, I thought your tail was spanked properly. So he still think I should have written the letter. Let us realize that Zionism has had some great success among us, and that some people have been bought and paid for, and that there are a group of conservative blacks. And I don't know what they're conserving except their miserable obscurity and their tragic cowardice. There is no home but home. And there's no home away from home. If we're going to thrive on this earth, all of us are going to have to come home and settle our differences among ourselves and be an African people and a world people and make up our mind that we will give the world a new humanity. Then say to the world, I've done it once. I'm ready to do it again. Thank you. Dr. Clarke, let's give her a hand. All right. Dr. Clarke and Dr. Mackey will be taking questions at this point. But those who are walking out, reach in your pocket and pull out $2. We cannot give these brothers what we raised tonight. All right? Everybody in the back, do not let anybody out. Block the doors.
The word Hebrew refers to a religion, and sometimes the people who follow that religion are referred to as Hebrews. But it's a religious connotation other than an ethnic connotation.
Okay, and also, I read somewhere where you had blacks during the Confederate War, the war between the states, serving on the Confederate side. Do you have any knowledge of that?
Blacks served on both sides. Yes, I do. Blacks served on both sides, but on the Confederate side, blacks served mostly as porters and quartermasters and blacksmiths and in the like, but not as frontline soldiers. That's a well-known fact, and it's also a well-documented fact. There's nothing specifically unusual about it. When you're a slave, you fight with the ones who give you the promise sooner. The 20,000 blacks fought with the British against the American in the American Revolution because the British got to them first and promised them freedom.
Dr. Clarke, could you please tell me whether or not King Leopold, the Belgian king, was he Jewish? I read certain articles that they said he may have been.
I never gave it a thought about him being Jewish, but I know this. I know that he killed in the Congo 3 times more people than Hitler killed as Jews in the so-called Holocaust. I'm not denying the German Holocaust, but I'm saying that it is small in comparison to other Holocausts in history. E.D. Burrell's work is good on this, and especially his King Leopold's Congo and the Black Man's Burden and the diaries of Roger Caseman. It's very good on this. And Mark Twain's little book called King Leopold's Soliloquy.
Professor Clarke, I often wonder, if there was no Hitler, what would have broke the Europeans back? Marcus Garvey was gone, and what would have been the force would have broken into Africa for us to move forward as a race as we did? If there was no Hitler,
I get the drift of the question, but I don't think we moved. No, had there been no Hitler, had there been no World War II, I think colonial hold over the life of people was weakening to the point where they still would have come from under it. And that the war, while helped in a great number of ways, it wasn't absolutely essential to this breakaway.
Could I make a comment on that, Dr. Clarke, please?
Yes, please, go.
No, that's this side. The other part of that, brother, is, and I think my learned colleague will agree with me, you cannot accept, as he said earlier, you don't accept their definitions, World War I, World War II, Korea. All of these are actually extensions of the same war. The seeds of World War II had to happen. Are you listening, sir?
Yes.
It had to happen because World War I had happened. They set in force in the most. Let me give you a concrete example that we like to do. What is happening in what they used to call, just until a few months, weeks ago, they were calling Yugoslavia, right? How did Yugoslavia come into being? Are you aware?
No, I'm not aware.
All right. And most people out here not. No, no crime. They haven't told you. Yugoslavia represented one of those examples we're talking about where at the end of World War I, the Europeans, just as they did in Africa, they cut off a little piece of Czechoslovakia. They created Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia out of a lot of other areas of Central Europe. And the reason they did this was to try to protect certain interests. In the process, they created the forces that there's now chickens coming home to roost. The only thing that held Yugoslavia in those Balkans, the term Balkanization come from that, where you take something and make a scramble out of it. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So as a result, once the hegemony of the Soviets fell apart, all of these people went right back to doing what they did again. What might help you understand that, if you will, there's a book by a racist gentleman called, by Lothrop Stoddard. You must have still read it. It's called The Rising Tide of Color. And the position he makes in the beginning, he says that what the Europeans did in World War I, where they brought in black folks or other people and made it all right to kill white folks, that they were making their doom because these people would not go back where they came from and be content to be subordinate again. And of course, he was right.
Another question I'd like to ask. What is taking place now in the world, as we've seen what's going on in Europe, we're seeing these forces being broken up again and new forces. This is blood purification. We're seeing that right now.
That's not blood purification. What's happening in, as I said earlier, what's happening in Yugoslavia? All of them people are slaughtering each other out of the same ethnic background. All of them. All of them people in Yugoslavia, the Bosnians, the Herzegovinians, the Croats, the Slovenes, are a different part of what they call the same ethnic group. So the struggle, and do not forget, it was in this same Sarajevo where this gentleman, the Serbian nationalist, assassinated the Archduke Ferdinand, which according to them triggered off what war? World War I. Now wait a minute, don't turn your back, you got a question
no.
here, because
no,
this
I'm not turning
let me
your
finish
back.
This, and give it to him, because I'm sure he'll want to add something to it. If you've been looking at, don't let these people do this thing of diverting your attention. I've told you before about the magician diverting your attention while he pulls the 20 million pound elephant out of a top hat. And the other thing, what he's saying about don't believe myths. And what you're saying is important. I'm not criticizing you. Remember, as we speak, Germans are beating up on and burning down barracks where foreign workers are working, and the rest of the Germans are standing up, egging them on, and they're walking around with slogans saying what? Germany for the Germans. What has changed? I don't know if Dr. Clarke may want to say that.
No, we're always looking at other people's fight and hearing other people's worries and thinking something is being done for us. If anything is going to be done for us, we're going to have to do it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Sorry. Dr. Clark, on the curriculum of inclusion, that is designed to deal with the misinformation in history. What direction do you think it should take at this time in order to expedite or to achieve the goal that is being sought? I have another one.
Well, I have repeatedly said I do not believe in the curriculum of inclusion. I believe in a curriculum of truth and curriculum of correction. And to include my history into a history that is incorrect is like pouring clean water into a dirty glass. I think general history is wrong, and white students are being cheated as well as blacks. I think there needs to be a total revision of history, then our history need to be brought into the total revision of history. And to just to include our history into an incorrect history is no achievement.
Yeah, the other point is, the question is that it is said that the Zionists collaborated with the Nazis in the extermination process. Could you elaborate?
That's well documented in the transfer agreement, and there's some other documented literature on it. It's not even a point for we need to argue. that they did, because they were willing to spare the youth, the rich, and the intellects. And that,
let me just add this. I think you were attending my Thursday night Sunday class.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And you purchased, I don't know, did you pick up the copy of Fate of the Jews?
I did, yeah. I didn't get to it yet.
There's a whole chapter in there that Sverlich has. There's a whole chapter in that book of The Fate of the Jews by Fröhlich, where she deals specifically and document, I think it's chapter 2 of that book. When you go home tonight at your learning friend, lay it out, that plus the bibliographical material is right in there. In other words, you've got the documentation in your hands, sir.
Yeah, but I think for the general body here, you may want to elaborate.
Oh, well, you didn't say that.
Dr. Clarke.
Yes.
You made mention of a priesthood, the creation of a priesthood, and it sounds similar to something that I read in Egyptian literature, where they speak about the Het Neter, the house of the god, in the sense that Ptah or Thoth or Osiris have their particular house and they specialize in a certain area. You know, they're almost like guilds. You know, I would like you to elaborate on, you know, the particular structure of a priesthood that you're mentioning, and, you know, how could, people participate in what you're putting together?
I was talking about something more practical. All right, now, if all you can do is to make good safety pins, you would belong to the technical priesthood. And you'd make good safety pins and train others to make good safety pins. But you won't stop at a safety pin, because if you can make a good safety pin, eventually you're going to make a good locomotive.
Okay, see, I understand of, you know, the fact of being practical, but with the structure, have something from the ancient civilization and blending it with something new?
It will have something from the ancient, something from the modern. It will be up to date and practical,
okay,
as it can possibly be. We'll take in modern practicality.
Okay, thank you.
You know.
I would like to direct a question to either of the doctors. I was listening tonight, you were talking about, you were dealing mostly with nationalities of the Jews, and I didn't really hear anybody deal with, I'm asking the question of, when did the years start when the big color structure of the whites dominating? What year was that?
The color?
Right.
Color? Did you use the word color?
Color, as in white and black.
In the 16th century, because prior to that, no one referred to a people as being a white people or a black people. The concept of color that we know today came out of the 15th and the 16th century in the rationale for the slave trade.
May I just add this also? You've got to look at this, son, in the concept. This whole thing about the nation state is also a recent phenomenon. When these people who they call Europeans came here, Christopher Columbus, they did not call themselves Europeans. The Spaniards, who we call, didn't even identify with a nation called Spain. Mm-hmm. He called himself an Algarinaz or a Grenadian or etc. So the color concept, all this, and the concept of modern nationalism, all of these things developed as a part and parcel of the spreading out of colonial and the African slave trade, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So if he says it started in the 15 and the 1600s.
No, not if he said that.
Okay. Yeah. Understood.
No, it couldn't have been. Why did you say if he said? He said that.
All right, so what happened before that then?
Well,
before that, people referred to people by their religion, their ethnic name.
Crafts?
Yeah. In Africa,
so
people,
it wasn't that problem, that's what I'm saying.
No, you made it a problem. But there were Africans married into European royalty before that. You have to study that 1,000 years before the slave trade. You got to study that 1,000 years before the slave trade in West Africa and 1,000 years in East Africa. You have to study the interrelationship between the Africans and the Romans and the Greeks, and study the role the Africans played in the formation of the Roman Empire, and when the Romans turned on the Africans who had assisted them. Okay. See, we got to have a holistic view of history. You just can't have just a little pinch of it. You got to take in a big
picture. I was just trying to get the direct year. So you said 15, 1600, and then before then. Thank you.
Yeah.
So the honored and distinguished professors, I'm indeed very happy, as usual, to be enlightened. I'm a minister and founder of a church dealing with the same basis, but apart from the few 12 grandmothers who come, people not being interested just here in Bedford, up, you know. I would like to ask this question, which I have not heard dealt with by any professor, and I wonder why. The spirituality of ancient Africa is well known, is well documented. And there's a beautiful book written by Richard King, M.D., The African Origin of Biological Psychiatry.
I'm familiar with the book, and I'm familiar with Dr. King, who's a personal friend.
Thank you, sir. And I wonder very much, why is that aspect included very much, because Africa was an extremely spiritual place, and this is what I try to bring out in my church, and where you can find and prove undoubtedly where everything is spirituality preceded everything that we know, which is just false. And why isn't it being said? I feel rather left out on that aspect. Without spirituality, you're nothing. And I say spirituality without religion.
Well, religion is comparatively recent.
Exactly.
Religion, in most cases, is artificial.
Definitely.
It's an artificial creation.
It's a cult.
Spirituality is supreme. It is spirituality. It is spirituality and not religion that separates man from the dog.
Beautiful.
Most or all organized Western religions are male chauvinist murder cults.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Clarke, for being here.
Thank you very much.
I like to keep this short. What can we do as a United African Movement to bring about a united Africa? What should we be doing?
Well, I think the long road starts with the person in the mirror. If you start uniting your family, your community, you move from that point on. All African people have the interests of all African people. Unite across all kind of lines and don't be divided by denominations and any kind of cults. A lot of people are hiding behind religions and copping out on their responsibilities.
Mm-hmm.
We're same people.
That's right.
I say, if you can't pass a taxi cab test, you're black.
All right. Thank you, God. Thank you.
Thank you.
The question I'm asked is more, like, I'm really seeking advice. Up at Lehman College, which is owned by the Jews, they have some bodies of our ancestors there.
Okay.
And we don't have the exact privilege to get to them as close as the Jews do. But we can come in there on Thursday evening from 5 until 7 p.m. in room 007. And they have a Jewish anthropologist there And we also have a black man who is an acting Yoruba priest. Now, something strange is happening because the Jewish anthropologist who is fighting the black community, he and the priests are yummy, yummy friends. And he and the Jew is in the ceremony shaking the they got something like a gourd that you shake when you beat the drum. And the Jew is shaking the gourd while the priest beat the drum. And we don't have any scholars or anybody up there that, you know, could observe this. And I really feel we're going to be sold out through this phenomenon. And the Jew is acting like he's so much for us. But it's a sad situation, and I need some advice.
Well, both the Jew and the priest could be a phony.
It sounds, neither the Jew or the priest sound real to me. We really need scholars there. And the bones really don't even supposed to be there, but sometimes we become alert a little too late and let things get out of our hands. If Jews want to dominate something, it's very easy to dominate us. So that's what they do, mainly because of a lack of alertness and gaining control over it. I don't have much patience with overnight people who become priests overnight. I know, see, I've lived in Africa and all over it, and I know that the apprenticeship for a priest is 7 years. People go to Africa, stay a few months, and come back a priest. I don't have that much patience for them. I can call myself a priest, but I know that I've never played any false games in my life. I don't intend to.
Okay, this question is directed for Professor Mackey. Being a student of Professor Mackey, I would like for you to elaborate on the so-called Jewish Holocaust, dealing with that they were not the only people, but talk about the other people that also went into those ovens. I think it's very important information.
Oh, good. Thank you, and it's
gypsies.
Yes, Ms. Brown, thank you. And if you, yes, unless you want to make a comment. That's a very important question, and the reason the lady asked, because I've dealt with it in the class. I don't know if I really want to share it with these people. They never come to the seminars. We announced that when we first came in here. Yeah, well, that's, we can be late for, that's, if you're late, you lose. Right. PS 258, but I said that before. No matter what you do, sometimes you're wrong. Well, I can't answer if everybody's going to talk at once, right? We meet every Thursday night from 7 until 10, PS 258, which is on Marcy and Macon. The entrance is on Macon Street, and we are there. It is an extension of UAM. They are the sponsors of it, and it's on the premises of where our leader, Mr. Canton, come here. And so they, in case they don't know who you are, do they say who he is? This is Roy Canton, who has made it possible for us to meet there. We have been meeting there for how long? About 9 months now. Every Thursday night, even while school is there, through his courtesy, we meet there from 7 until 10. The entrance, as I said, is on Macon Street. We are on the second floor. Once you come in, we're right down the hall. You wouldn't have a problem. If the doors close, you ring the bell, and somebody will let you in. Now, to get to your question, Ms. Brown, and it is very important, and that is very true, because once again, it shows you
When you all finish, I'll finish. No, come on. If you're going to talk, then you don't want to hear what I got to say. The lady asked a question. At least show enough. How the hell are we going to get unity if we can't even respect each other in a place like this? You don't tell me you'll die for me if you can't even be quiet while I'm talking. Now, the importance of this is very true because, and it shows on two levels, the importance of propaganda and constantly hammering at something. There were, by all accounts, over 14 million human beings that was iced in the Holocaust. Of the 14 million, Jews only claim at most 5 million. The question then becomes, who made up the other 9 millions? Well, let's tell you who made them up. I'm not even just going to talk about another thing. There were 350,000 people of black of all kinds. Oh, yes. They captured 75,000 Senegalese who were French soldiers. That's documented. Were iced. Over 20,000 Caribbeans of various... Oh, yeah. See, while we watching each other in the color business. Yeah. The British Army lost over 20,000 of their so-called colonials from the islands, etc., etc. And the French, outside of what they used to call Equatorial Africa, was supposed to have lost another 30,000. We had from American blacks, if you want to know, Afro-American call now, who got caught in Germany when World War II broke out. Most of them were, some were living in France and other places, most of them were never seen again. We know that Josephine Baker, so this is documented, Josephine Baker was only able to escape by going where? To North Africa, staying there. We had one of our outstanding and very talented entertainers, a woman by the name of Valeda Snow. She at one time was very close to Earl Hines. She played all the instruments in the orchestra expertly. She was a dancer on all form taps, thing whatnot. Valeda was captured while on tour in Belgium and was put in a concentration camp, and she was only saved by virtue before the Americans got into the war, and she was gotten out, smuggled out into France, and it ruined this woman. When she came back, her health was ruined. Valeda died, I think, about 1949 or 1950. If you're into music, and you should be, there's a few recordings around of her playing trumpet, etc. She was a pioneer jazz musician in the sense of the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, of Melba Liston, etc., etc., etc. Now, that takes care of another thing. Now, the gypsies, the largest percentage, as we know, that we know of, were gypsies. At the outbreak of World War II, there were 2 million documented gypsies, the people of what they call the Zigeuner, because gypsy is really a word like nigger, don't forget that, in Europe. 500,000, a half a million of them were iced. So that's 25%. The largest percentage group were them. To date, they haven't got a dime. And remember what Dr. Clarke just said. We are only now beginning to know their story because it's only in the last 10 years that their writers have begun to document what happened to them. They didn't have an international network to the extent the Jews and others had. So I thank you for asking that question. That puts that in perspective. Now, let me point out one other thing, show you the other thing. In our seminar a few weeks ago, the New York Post ran a whole series of letters where these people was knocking the whole idea of reparations for us. And those who are in my class have copies of this. And they overwhelmed all of those letters, according to the name, were all written by Jews. Am I right? And one gentleman by the name of Richard Steinberg said, if anybody owed anybody reparations, that blacks owed Jews reparations. Oh, watch this now. He said, oh, yes, we owed them reparations. Here's the logic, the convoluted logic. Now, remember, these are the folks that for years told us that the Egyptians were white, right? Am I right, Dr. Clarke? All right. Now, they said,
We owe the Jews reparations because the black Egyptians had put the Jews in slavery. That's correct. Am I lying? You see what the man said? They switch anytime whatever they need to say. In other words, that the Egyptian, the black Egyptian, had put Jews in slavery, and we therefore owed them reparations because our folks, the Egyptian, put them in slavery. And 20 years ago, they were saying the Egyptians had nothing to do with blacks or Africa. Right? Another gentleman said, what were we complaining about that the only Africans sold into slavery, all the Africans sold into slavery, were sold into slavery by other Africans, all of them, and went on to say, not one white man ever set foot in Africa to sell one slave. All right? The other gentleman took the position that what were we complaining about because over 600,000 people had died here to free us from slavery, almost all of them white. Am I quoting correctly? All right? Almost all of them white. So you see, if you don't get your story out there, right? Another Jewish gentleman said, and don't laugh, this whole reparations bit for us was a joke because we could not hold the present generations responsible for what other generations had done. So I would expect that next week I will see that the World Jewish Congress, the American Jewish Congress, and the Zionists will all come together for a joint conference where they will repudiate any more reparations from Germany for the Holocaust and, of course, will return all monies that they have received so far. Because if the present white folks here ain't liable for what happened to us before, obviously the present Germans ain't liable to what happened to them. Thank you.
Let's give them a big hand. Let us all stand. We're getting ready to leave. Let us hold hands. Let me acknowledge Charles Jordan of the College of New Rochelle, who is here with us tonight. Brother Jordan. Brother Jordan, you could bring students out to the slave. We want to acknowledge his presence. We're also glad to see Sister Shirley Brown here tonight as well. And let me remind you, next week, September 2nd, Wednesday, political rally for Al Sharpton. I want you all here on time. If we don't do anything else, we're going to punish our enemies. We don't do anything else. Repeat after me. We're an African people. We were once deceived. We will never be deceived again. Moses will not free us. We must free ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right.
Where is your cap? Yeah, I got it for
you. Go ahead.
Okay, before you go, I just want to recap some of these